purchase. In 1869, at exactly the same time the commutation scheme began, the government in Trinidad opened up the crown lands for sale in relatively small portions. Previously, you'd had to buy huge blocks, which meant nobody except wealthy capitalists could. But from 1869, it was possible to purchase 5 or 10 acres of crown land at reasonable prices. And as a result, many thousands of ex-indentured Indians and many thousands of Trinidadians of other ethnic groups purchased crown land. So it was mainly through the purchase and leasing of land that Indians acquired real estate property.
Some settled within close proximity of the sugarcane fields and factories and continued to work on the estates. Others became their own zamindars or landowners and began hiring freed immigrants to work for them, growing food crops and vegetables, cultivating sugarcane, reaping cocoa and coffee, and rearing animals. With the passage of time, they'd purchase more land. These concepts of thrift and sacrifice resulted from adversity and hardships of plantation life. They pinched at their earnings to purchase only what they did not produce from the land. Oftentimes, they were regarded as penurious or stingy, but were in fact saving for the proverbial rainy day. By 1884, some of them had accumulated appreciable savings from their meager estate earnings. Gradually, they began acquiring wealth and applied to their inheritances the raw skills of peasantry and dharmic devotion to the land. They reclaimed swamps, cleared forests, and constructed houses of mud walls and thatch roofs that seemed simple, yet with sound economic principles that reflected their culture of frugality.
Rosy Lac area was made up of Indians who had migrated from other parts of Trinidad to Rosy Lac in the Oropouche Lagoon, where such land was being made available.
The wealthier among the immigrants demonstrated a greater ambition and acquired, instead of thatch roofs, galvanized coverings to secure their houses. For the first time since arrival in 1845, they really enjoyed privacy and space to raise families. Slowly they began to express more openly, albeit with considerable official resistance, their rich cultural traditions, whether in dance, the music of their forefathers that kept burning in their hearts, or the songs that would subliminally transport them back to Mother India in times of despair and desperation. As the system of indentureship continued, new shiploads of Girmitias or agreement signers would arrive from different parts of the Indian subcontinent, bringing their own customs and traditions and adding to the opulent repository of time-honored rituals, festivals, and ceremonies.
What are some of these customs and traditions, and how have they survived in cosmopolitan Trinidad and Tobago? How have the immigrants fared in an environment unkind and unfriendly, and sometimes even hostile?
The pioneering Indian stepped off the ship and onto this land of a brighter tomorrow with anticipation. They brought almost no material possession, except a jahaji bundle of clothing, some musical instruments, thousands of stories or kisas in their heads, multiple skills, a few holy books, and an abiding faith in their religious beliefs. They knew, whatever the circumstances, they possessed the knowledge and capacity to persevere, and they did, invariably invoking that strong inner spirit to reincarnate village India and to use the experience of plantation life as a lesson in human survival and enterprise.
The story of Ram was the story of exile, and the story of the jahajis, or forefathers who came on an intendership, was a story of exile also. And because they hardly had any text with them in the early time, they remembered
the traditions of Ram, and that is what was a term of reference for them to adapt into this landscape and to be able to use as a guide, a moral and principle guide for their own life. So you see, the Ramayana text really, and the inspiration of the Ramayana is what set their whole life.
The immigrants came with an education and a sense of worship that took many forms, whether it was to Dharti Mata or the earth, the river or Ganga Maya, the stone or the flower. Therefore, the absence of the physical structure was never an impediment in the observance of their religious practices. They sang their Ramayana and performed their pujas under shady peepal or mango trees. Invariably, on evenings they would gather under these sacred grounds to sing their lullabies and entertain themselves, trying to heal the wounds of defeat on the estates. The majority of Muslim immigrants in an undivided India brought many of their religious beliefs and doctrines, but few public observances.
The Muslim religion has the basic festival which you have is Eid al-Adha and Eid al-Fitr. Then you have the Ramadan, which is a slow month of sacrifice. You can't eat things that are normally lawful during that period. So the strictness of the religion is the answer, the reason why you do not see Islam being projected in a sort of a fetish mode or in a celebratory mode like that. They don't do that.
Eid al-Fitr, which marks the end of the Ramadan fasting, is perhaps the most universal celebration in the Islamic calendar, and one on which Muslims universally are on common ground. Eid al-Adha, or celebration of the Prophet's birthday, is another. However, according to retired Justice Ralf Narayan, what they knew and practiced in their villages formed the sum total of what came with the Islamic jihadis.
They brought, of course, such of the Islamic training, which I'm sure was rather unorthodox, but which arose out of practice among them in their own villages. So that they knew of mosques, they knew of Quranic readings, they knew of singing qasidas. But outside of that, I don't think they brought anything Sikh, for example, in music, because at one time it was thought that music was anathema to Islam. Painting, I don't recall anything coming in that form of art from the Muslim community. Hosse, that came down because that had its origin in the martyrdom of the grandsons of the Prophet Hassan and Hussein.
This point of view is supported by Dr. Prabhu Mohapatra, who says that Hosse was a major commemoration in Lucknow, a city from where thousands of immigrants came to the Caribbean.
It was there in almost all North Indian cities in the 19th century, it would be practiced. But the biggest and the best was in Lucknow, which was the Shiite kingdom, the Awadh kingdom. And that's where a lot of people came from also to Trinidad, also to other countries. What is interesting is that Muharram, the celebration or the kind of Muharram became the festival, the only perhaps the most important festival for Indians wherever they went in the plantations, wherever. That means to Mauritius, to Malaysia, to Suriname, to Fiji, to everywhere, to West Indies. It was there. It was there throughout the 19th century, the single most important festival. And there, both Hindus and Muslims, all sects, would participate.
But whilst Hosse has its origins in the sands of Karbala in Iraq, and in fact came with the immigrants from India, it is considered un-Islamic by conventional Muslims.
The ordinary Muslims who don't believe in Hosse, they read the Quran and they make prayers and so on for the soul of Imam Hussein, because Imam Hussein was slaughtered by the enemies of the Prophet who never believe in God and who were believing in propagating themselves. So that tradition came down here from the east into Trinidad, where a number of people gathered and built these structures, which they call Hussein, very beautiful, but it is to the Orthodox Muslims un-Islamic.
The majority of Muslims in Trinidad and Tobago are Sunnis, and Hussein is observed primarily by Shiite Muslims. It is considered by some to be one of the more visually attractive events that has some traditional Hindu characteristics. Hence the reason Hindus and other non-Muslim groups participate in the event each year.
The early Muslims did not know of these divisions. Those who are Sunnis are those who are supposed to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet. So when I say follow the Sunnah of the Prophet, in addition to the Holy Quran.
However, for the immigrants, Hussein, with all its solemnity, represented more an Indian rather than an Islamic commemoration, and gave them an opportunity to demonstrate, mainly through the procession, an integral component of their history.
It is a point of display, of showing that we are a community. We live here not merely as labor, but we also have a life and world outside. It was also a way in which they wanted to get out of the immobilized condition on the plantation. And that's why it was so popular. It allowed them express themselves and imprint themselves on the public space.
Notwithstanding this issue, the Islamic presence in Trinidad and Tobago is noticeably strong, and Muslims play an important role in the cohesiveness of this plural society through religion, education, and commerce.
The course of history has provided for all of us a place in this cosmopolitan island paradise of Trinidad and Tobago. Therefore, the way we choose to live or interact with each other would determine to what extent we really understand and respect the pains, sufferings, and sacrifices of our ancestors who made the crossings, whether they came first, second, or third. It would also demonstrate what we've learned from these lessons of history in order to shape our own future and to ensure that we do not repeat the evils of European imperialism. Whilst the planters quite naturally sought to reclaim their pound of flesh labor, invariably through cruel, hostile, and repugnant ways, the Indians invoked their cultural resilience and adaptation as perhaps the most persistent form of resistance against the barbarity of plantation life. A quality, and indeed a culture, they've passed on to succeeding generations, unquestionably a legacy worthy of emulation. I'm Gideon Hanuman Singh. Thank you for viewing.